coming. My name is Eric Potty. I'm the manager of programming with the Airdrie Public Library. And we are very pleased to be able to offer this storytelling and story share project and to learn more about it. Before we do get underway, I would like to take this opportunity to acknowledge the traditional territories of the Blackfoot and the people of the Treaty 7 land region in Southern Alberta, as well as the Métis Region 3, which includes the Siksika, the Piikani, Kainai, Tsuut'ina, the Stoney Nakoda First Nations, including Chicanee, Bearspaw, and Wesley First Nation. In acknowledging the traditional territories of the people of the Treaty 7 region, we are giving recognition to the fact that this is their traditional lands, and while a shared home now, our ancestors were in fact guests and not owners. Once again, I would like to thank you all for coming. It should be quite a bit of fun tonight. We'll learn quite a bit. I'm excited to learn more about this program. As someone from the East Coast, stories and storytelling has always been a very big part of my area's culture and experience. So I really look forward to being able to hear more about it out here in the prairies. Before I turn things over to our MC, Doreen, I will just have a little bio here. So Doreen Vanderstoop is a storyteller, musician, and writer based in Calgary, Alberta. She is the co-founder and project manager of StoryShare, an initiative of Storytelling Alberta that connects seniors through story. Doreen sings, plays guitar, and performs oral stories of all kinds for all audiences of all ages. Her debut novel, Watershed, was published by Freehand Books in May of 2020. And I know for sure there is a copy here at the library because I walked by it today. So you can grab a copy here at the Airdrie Public Library. And with that, I will pass things over to Doreen. Doreen, I'm just going to spotlight you so that everyone can see you right away.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much, Eric. It is wonderful to be here with you again. You were so kind to bring me in for a program last year for Watershed. And thank you for mentioning it again. That was very lovely of you. I'd like to acknowledge your strong oral storytelling background from where you come from. I think that's fantastic. I know how much you appreciate oral storytelling because of that. And I also want to acknowledge that the traditional land, is of the Indigenous people here, and that there is a very strong oral storytelling tradition among the Indigenous people too, who have occupied this land for thousands and thousands and thousands of years. So every civilization on Earth has had a strong oral storytelling tradition, and we are so happy to bring that forward into the modern world in a whole new way, telling all kinds of stories. So that's what we're all about tonight, is we're going to talk story. And I'd like to acknowledge the two people who have joined me tonight from StoryShare. One of those is Marissa Singh, and she's one of our volunteers, has been with us since the very beginning. And I'm going to tell you a little bit more about Marissa when I introduce her a little bit later on. And the other amazing person who has joined us tonight is Elaine Montgomery. Elaine began as a client with us. She did story share sessions. She joined tellarounds. She also did two legacy video recordings with us, which we're going to talk about tonight as well. And so she is here to talk about her experiences with story share. And again, I will introduce her a little bit more fully a little bit later on. Now, as somebody who likes to bring songs into the programs, I cannot start this program without doing a song. So I would like to start by doing something that signifies what storytelling really is all about. This is a beautiful song called You've Got a Friend by Carole King. And you need some loving care, and nothing is going right. Close your eyes and think of me. Soon I will be there to brighten up even your darkest night. You just call up my name, and you know wherever I am, I'll come running.
to see you again. Winter, spring, summer, or fall, all you have to do is call, and I'll be there. Yes, I will. You've got a friend. If the sky above you grows dark and full of clouds, and that old north wind begins to blow, keep your head together and call my name out loud. Soon you'll hear me knocking at your door. Sing it with me wherever you are. You just call up my name, and you know wherever I am, I'll come running to see you again. Winter, spring, summer, or fall, all you have to do is call, and I'll be there. You've got a friend.
All right. I love that song. It's amazing. And I think, thank you for singing along, Elaine. It was lovely to have you there in the background. I know it doesn't work perfectly on Zoom, but it was lovely to have your voice there anyways.
Could you actually hear my voice?
Yes, I could. It was all good. I just wanted to say that one of the kindest things you can do for a friend is listen to their story. And that's what we're all about, is listening to stories. Now, I don't know if you can see my button. You see my button? Tell me your story. This is what I wear when I go to any kind of program that I'm doing about story, because if there's one thing I love is listening to people's stories. So I have the privilege of being the project manager for StoryShare, but I'm also a storyteller. And so I get to go into various places and tell stories, and then I get to hear stories from others. And it's just such a wonderful, wonderful thing. So let me tell you a little bit about the StoryShare project and how it got started. It's all part of an initiative called Igniting Neighbors, and it was started by the Calgary Seniors Resource Society in the fall of 2019. They put out a call to organizations around Calgary to put in proposals for programming for isolated seniors. And so my colleague Mary Hayes and I, we came up with this StoryShare program, and we put it to them, and they were delighted with it, and so they accepted it and put it in the roster of, I believe it's eight projects total that are part of Igniting Neighbors, that are also other organizations around Calgary are also part of it. And so we were all set to start. We'd signed our contract. We were all ready to start in March. And we all know what happened in March. Everything exploded. And so nothing went ahead. Everything was put on the back burner, and we waited. However, Calgary Seniors Resource Society approached all of us then and said, we have some extra funding, because funding for this program is provided by New Horizons through the federal government. And they said, we have some extra money. Do you have a way to provide your program through the pandemic virtually? And we went, yeah, we could sure do that. Absolutely, no problem. And so they gave us a little extra money to start with. And we began the StoryShare by phone project. That's how it all started. And then as the pandemic went on and everybody became a little more comfortable with video platforms, we began to do it on video platforms, Zoom, FaceTime, WhatsApp, whatever people wanted to, however they wanted to meet, we were happy to meet with them. So in that way, we were able to bring this project still into the pandemic and really connect people. Because at that point, we were all isolated. So we weren't just providing services to seniors or isolated seniors. Every senior was isolated at that point. So we had we had great success through the whole, and ongoing great success through the whole pandemic, because of course, the pandemic's not over. so great, in fact, that I was tallying the numbers today right up until the present. And I am absolutely thrilled and proud and delighted to tell you that we have had, since May of 2020 till today, we have had 685 service engagements through StoryShare. It's just, it just blows my mind that we've been just so, so successful. And some of those are repeat clients, of course, because, you know, just spending 20 minutes with somebody to share a story and hear theirs, well, that's hardly enough to build any kind of rapport. So we are able to provide three services to them. So let me get into what the services are, just so everybody knows what it is we actually do. So the first thing we offer are one-on-one sessions with one or two seniors. And so in that case, we have a storyteller and one of our volunteers, like Marissa Singh and Elaine Montgomery. We have one of them join in the session. The storyteller shares a story of their own, and then the senior client is invited to share a story of their own or to give reflections on the storyteller's story. And then the volunteer is invited in to share their reflections or share a story of their own. And they also check in with the senior to see if there's any service they might need, if there's anything that we can connect them to, whether it's grocery delivery or home repair services or anything in between. We can link them up to the long list of resources that we have at our fingertips to help people with their needs. So that's the one-on-one session. And people can have up to three of those. So you can meet with a StoryShare storyteller and volunteer three times. The next service we offer is a tell-around, and that is a warm story sharing circle with a group of people. And again, we've been doing these online. We do them on Zoom, and great fun. We have all our little squares on the screen, and the storyteller again starts with a story. And then the other participants are invited to share a story of their own as well. And people can attend unlimited numbers of tell-arounds. They can come to every single one of our tell-arounds if they like. And it's a wonderful way to build community. The third offering we have, very special. We're so proud of this particular offering because this is our legacy project. And Elaine is going to talk a little bit more about that again later on. The Legacy Project is all about recording stories of seniors in our community so that we value the stories that they have to tell and we celebrate their lived history. It's so important for us to know what happened to our elders and in the days gone by so that we have those stories to carry forward for our own children in the future. So those are the three services. In terms of the legacy, I should explain, we do a legacy story video, or we also do an interview. Some people say, well, I don't really have a story to tell. Then we say, if you want to do an interview with us, we have a list of 12 questions. You can choose five of them, and we can ask those for you in a recorded interview. And then that forms the legacy interview video. So those are the services we have to offer. What I'd like to do now, actually, before we move on to my other guest speakers that we have, I'd like to share one of our legacy videos. And this one is special because we have a new partnership with Deaf and Hear Alberta. And they have provided captioning and interpretation right in the video. So we gave them our video and they put the interpretation and the captions in. So that's a lovely new thing. We'd like to do that with all our videos. We have about 40 of our legacy videos now on our Storytelling Alberta YouTube channel. We'd love to do that with all of them, but that will take some time. But the first one I'd like to share is a wonderful little 4-minute video by Shirley Handy. And she has a wonderful tale to tell about growing up on the farm in Alberta. It's called Running Afoul in the Farmyard. And that is Shirley Handy's video that I love. It's one of my favorites. Oh, I'm going to have to... Yikes. Yes, if you let YouTube go on, it will go on. All right. Sorry about that. So I'd like to introduce Marissa Singh now, and she is one of our amazing volunteers. As I said, she's been with us from the start, and I have a little bio for her. So Marissa is a recent graduate from the UBC Kinesiology Program. Since graduating, she has developed a deep interest in health promotion and wants to work in healthcare someday. She loves walking her dog, painting, watching movies, and volunteering for StoryShare, of course. She also loves a cheesy joke every now and again, so don't hesitate to share if you have one. Marissa is very excited to be our volunteer representative on this call today and hopes you all have as great a time as she will. Marissa.
All right. So hi, everyone. I'm really excited to be here today as StoryShare's volunteer representative and also share my experiences over the past year that I've been volunteering with them. So as a volunteer, my role within the organization is sort of based around participating in reciprocal storytelling between seniors in the Calgary community and storytellers. My main responsibility in these calls is to check with the seniors to ensure that they're keeping well and connecting them with any resources that they may need to make their daily living easier, along with my own story every now and again. Since starting, I've been able to listen to so many wonderful stories that have been told by all of the tellers, and even more amazing stories that have been told by our participating seniors. Hearing the clients' life stories, their anecdotes about their early family experiences or their relationships, or sometimes even their careers, has been something that I have really cherished over the last year, considering, you know, what the last year has brought the entire world. Considering the hardships that the pandemic has brought for a lot of us, particularly a lot of the older adults in our communities, StoryShare has been an experience that has not only allowed me to bring positivity to the lives of a lot of these isolated seniors, hopefully, but also engage in interactions that have brought a lot of positivity to my own life. One of my favorite calls was back in 2020, when one of our clients told me and the storyteller that I was working with about the winters that they had spent living in a farmhouse in rural Alberta. As you can imagine, all of my winter blues just kind of fell away, considering that there was a lot of perspective brought with what rural Alberta winters must have been like. But that one interaction brightened up my entire day, as have all of the calls that I've had the privilege to be a part of through StoryShare. It really is amazing how much connecting with one person through a story can bring to your life. And that's why StoryShare is such an amazing and important organization in our community, from bad times like the pandemic to really great times. As a volunteer, I would really encourage anyone that has the time or the ability to be a part of this to, apply to be a volunteer. Because like I said, it's brought a really awesome dimension to my everyday interactions and getting to hear lots of different stories from people who have a lot more life experience than I do. So it's been a really positive thing in my life, and hopefully a way that I've been able to sort of bring that positivity to other people's lives as well. So yeah, it's been a really awesome time, and I would encourage anyone to volunteer if they can.
Wonderful, Marissa. Thank you so much for that. I just have a question for you before we move on. I want to just bring you back for a second, because I'm curious if you've had a chance to share any stories of your own, or stories from maybe even some folk tales that you might have known or discovered in on your travels through the whole world of storytelling now that you've entered it?
Yeah, like I said, I do, along the way, I've, contributed my own stories to the calls that I've been able to be part of. Some of them have been like stories from my own life. Through like travels that I've done, I haven't had that much experience traveling, but I've been able to give those. I've also done a lot of stories, like you said, folk tales. And a lot of it has been sort of interesting because I've been able to discover stories from like my own culture. I'm Indian. I've been able to give some of those stories, which has been really cool because it's something for me to learn. It's something for me to give to other people to learn. I've also done a lot of stories when it comes to like Greek mythology and stuff like that. I find that kind of really interesting. So I've given a lot of stories, you know, with that. I remember, I think the last story that I told was of the Greek god Cupid and his sort of love story on Earth. And that was a really fun story to tell because it was related to the theme of the call that I was doing, which was like love stories. So yeah, I've been able to tell a lot of really cool stories that have, you know, come from a bunch of different cultures, which has been a really awesome experience for me to learn as well. Yeah.
That's excellent. I know I had the privilege of hearing one of the stories that you told from your culture. So that's why I wanted you to talk about that a little bit, because that was amazing. And obviously everybody can now tell that our volunteers also get bitten by the storytelling bug and begin to tell stories of their own, which we are absolutely delighted about, because that's what it's all about, is really sharing. I also want to mention that we also have a multi-generational component to this. So it's wonderful to have different generations talking to each other and sharing, which is amazing as well. So what I'd like to do now is just share a little story with everybody. This is just the kind of story you might hear from me when we get together during a story share session with a client and a volunteer. So this one is called Mishap to Miracle, and it's a family story, one of my favorites that I love to tell about my dad. My family moved here from the Netherlands in 1968. Now, I don't know if it was because the land we came from was as flat as you can imagine, but my parents took to the mountains like birds take to flying. They loved to take us there whenever they possibly could. They particularly loved to take us to places that had water. So lakes, Bow Lake, Takaka Falls, one of our favorite places. But one of our favorite places closer to home was Upper Kananaskis Lake. And that, of course, was at the end of Highway 40. But Highway 40 in around the early 70s was not a paved road. It was a gravel logging road. And so there weren't too many people who ever went into that area. And for my parents, the more out of the way, the quieter, the fewer people, the better. Well, one particular September weekend, we were heading out for our last sort of fall, you know, family picnic get together at the lake. And we headed up that gravel road. And finally, we got to Upper Kananaskis Lake. Now, that morning, my dad had said, OK, kids, let's go swimming when we get there. And myself and my three siblings, we went, Dad, no way. We know how cold that mountain lake is. No way. But my dad was so excited about swimming in the lake. He wore his swimming trunks to the lake. Like he was all ready by the time we got there. So we got there, parked alongside, he locked the car. We went down to the lake shore and my dad jumped into the water. Well, he was always great for entertaining us. He was always a clown. So he did cartwheels in the water. He did backflips. He did handstands. Handstands were his absolute specialty. So he did that for a while. He'd come out, warm up a little. He'd go back in again. Finally, it was lunchtime. We had our picnic. Afterwards, he went in again and he swam around some more, did some more backflips and handstands. Well, by the end of the afternoon, the shadows were coming across the lake towards us, and we knew it was time to go home. My dad took one more dip and then he came out of the water and he did this to his pockets. He was looking for his keys. Now the car was locked. We couldn't get in. It was going to be a cold night. And the keys were somewhere out in the lake. So he turned around, went back into the lake, and he dove under, and he's swimming around everywhere that he'd been swimming and doing handstands and cartwheels. But he couldn't find those keys. So he came out, and he began to pace on the shore. And he was thinking to himself, he told us later, there must be something. There must be something we can do. Well, we were getting quite nervous. I remember those butterflies flying around in my stomach, wondering if we were all going to freeze on the shores of Upper Kananaskis Lake that night. But then my dad stopped, and it was like that light bulb went on over his head. And he ran up to our big white station wagon, and he leaned down in front of the, at the side of the car, front passenger side wheel well. And he reached up inside and he pulled out a key. Well, we rejoiced, couldn't believe that my dad had worked that kind of magic. So he opened the car door and we all piled in. And somewhere in the recesses of his mind, he had remembered that the person he'd bought the car from had said, and if you ever need an extra key, there's one in the wheel well at the front. He remembered. I think my dad taught us a little bit about resiliency that day, because he always seemed to demonstrate to us that doesn't matter what kind of trouble you get into, there's always something you can do to get out of it. And that's my story about my dad. So that's the kind of thing you'll hear. And then I would invite the client to share a story of their own. Maybe they have a story about their dad or their family that they'd like to tell. And we just love hearing people's stories. So I just want to talk briefly about the benefits of storytelling. There's definitely some science behind all of this. And probably first and foremost is that storytelling and stories, listening and telling stories, stimulate every part of our brains. It's amazing what it does. Then the next thing is it helps us relax. It helps us get out of our day-to-day troubles, and that helps us relax. Then it lights up our imagination, and then it inspires us to feel. And connecting with your feelings can really help you with problem-solving skills. And of course, the last one and the most powerful is the fact that stories connect us. And that's what we found about the StoryShare project. We have made amazing connections between storytellers, storytellers and volunteers, storytellers and clients, volunteers and clients. It's been absolutely amazing. So I'd like to introduce our other guest speaker tonight, and that is Elaine Montgomery. Elaine became a client with StoryShare quite early on. She is a nurse by profession and is now retired. And she was also a doula in her life. She's going to tell us a little bit more about that as well. But Elaine, as I said, she joined a couple of sessions, and then we did two legacy recordings with Elaine. One of them was a video that I'm going to share a little section of after Elaine has spoken, and the other is an interview that she did. And the interviewer was a student from the Calgary French and International School, which is another partnership we've been able to establish and will resume this fall with those students. And that's been a beautiful thing as well to see. So Elaine, please take it away and tell us about your experience with StoryShare.
Well, thank you very much, Doreen. And it's been a great journey. And I just have to tell you and whoever is listening, if you decide that you're going to be a storyteller, I actually got involved. Doreen phoned me about something else because I'd been working at the church. We were doing a project for seniors. And COVID hit, and all of a sudden, nothing was happening. And for some reason, Doreen phoned to ask me about what we'd been doing. So she told me about the StoryShare, and I said, oh, that sounds interesting. But what I discovered was that I wasn't allowed to write my story and read it. And that caused me great angst, because I thought, I can't memorize the whole story and tell the story without reading something. And so I had to memorize the story, which you're going to hear, called The Elephant's Farewell, and tell the story. And I have to say that Doreen and her colleague were very helpful with helping me get through that, the angst of telling the story. But I really believe that stories are important, that especially when you get to a certain age, we have so many stories from back in the dark ages, as I like to call it, when we were much younger. And today's children don't know a lot of the stuff that we did that we just take for granted. Just the other day, somebody was talking about something and said, I bet you don't know what a fag is. And we said, of course we know what a fag is. Well, that's the old fashioned term for a cigarette. And just, there's so many things that we knew about that we did. The other thing is, telephone boxes out on the street. Today's kids have no idea what all of that was about. And I just think it's important for people of a certain age to continue to tell the stories and for the children to hear about what the stories are, because for them, it's all new and different and it's quite fun. And one of the students who interviewed me, I It was really great because she was so enthusiastic and it reminded me of stories that I hadn't thought of for a long time. And so it's just a great communication of talking to people who are younger, and at my age, almost everybody's younger. And it's really quite fun. And one of the other things as a do, I've had various careers in my life, most of them around nurse, some type of nursing, but I became a doula, which is somebody who looks after mothers and fathers when their babies are going to be born. We're not medical. We're just there to support the mothers and dads. And I would look after them. I'd visit with them a few times during while they were expecting, and then be with them for the birth. And after the birth, I took pictures if they wanted them, and I would take pictures, and then I would write a story and put it together and give it to them afterwards. Which it was fun because a lot of times they were some of the things that I always wrote the good stuff. I didn't ever write anything that they probably didn't want to remember. But there were things that I would write in the story that they would not have remembered at all. And so I would just give them the story and they would have it for as long as they wanted to keep it. And one of the couples I had, I looked after them twice. They had two boys that were born about 2 years apart. And I was talking to them a few years later, and they told me that they had decided, they had their birth story, and then every year on the children's birthdays, mother and father each wrote what they remembered of the child for that year, and they would write it down, and on the child's birthday, they would read the birth story plus the story of the mother and the dad for that year, and that was what they did with these boys when they were growing up. And I just think that those stories, if we all keep connected, we learn not only the children learn what the parents are remembering, but then the children can start talking to the parents about what is going on. And I really think that that is a very important part of our lives, is to learn all the things that we remember about what happened with us, and then pass it on to the children so that they have some idea of what their parents and grandparents' lives were like when they were the same age that the children are now. And it's very, very different at times. And then sometimes it isn't all that different. And it just gives a special connection when you know how your parents have lived, parents and grandparents have lived in their younger days. So that's been very special for me. So I did my first story share, which is the video that we're going to look at. And then since then, the other thing that I did as a doula, I was teaching doulas. So one of the things I like to do was take pictures, and I used to do PowerPoint presentations. So I got very used to working with computers. So Doreen has asked me if I would help others get used to doing a computer, because I'm not afraid of punching buttons and fiddling around with the computer. So I'm always happy to help anybody who's having issues with it. And it's amazing because there's a lot of people at my age who've not used computers, and there's others who are very computer literate and they're just fine with it. And I just enjoy helping them with it because it's fun. And one of the issues always is, how do you turn it on? Who knew? And going from there. So anyway, so that's been very interesting for me. And also I love to talk to people on the phone, so that's fine too. So anyway, Doreen, it's been wonderful, and thank you so much for inviting me to be part of the group and tell us some of the stories.
I have a question for you, Elaine.
Absolutely.
Inject myself and ask you this. I have a couple of questions for you because I did want to mention the iPads. We have 5 iPads with the StoryShare project that we are able to lend out to our clients to use for a period of time, and then they can access our services through that iPad. And Elaine is one of our volunteers that helps connect people to StoryShare through those iPads. So we actually have tech support and we have data on those machines. So please, people can get in touch with us for that as well. We have 2 of them signed out now, but we've got 3 just sitting downstairs by my front door, ready to go. So, if people are interested in that, then that's great. I wanted to ask you about when you got into technology, because I love that story about your husband encouraging you encouraging you to be tech savvy. Can you tell us about that?
You want me to tell you that? Well, my husband was one of the first people who started using computers. He was very clever with mathematics, and he was a geologist, but then he was working for Shell Oil, and so he was developing programs. He was the one who developed the programs for the geologists and then wrote these very thick manuals on how you ran the computer. So this was very early on in our marriage. And then when computers became more popular, I thought, oh, well, maybe I should get a computer. And I, first of all, asked him what kind of computer I should get. And he said to me, well, what do you want to do with it? And I said, I have no idea. He said, well, you have to decide what you're going to do with it. Fine. And then when I got it, I said, will you help me with it? And he said, no, if you're going to have a computer, you have to learn to do it yourself. And I think he just felt he had no patience with somebody who was a newbie and figure it out for yourself. And of course, that made me slightly annoyed. And I thought, fine, that's what I will do. And I did. So I learned how to turn it on. And he never, ever, even later on, if I had to phone home and needed some information off my computer, he wouldn't even turn it on and look for me. I absolutely had to do it myself. And I was also teaching doulas. And by this time I was well into my 50s, and they're like in their 20s and 30s. And so these girls that I was teaching, they were by that time computer literate. And they always just, I'd say, oh, I can't do it. They'd say, of course you can, Elaine, just get busy and learn. So that's why I had to learn. And that's why I got very comfortable with computers, because I got no sympathy from anyone. And now my daughter, who was also, she was very good with computers also. She's starting in grade 9. And if we're sitting in the same room working on our iPads and I have a problem, I'll say, oh, Kat, how do I do whatever? And she'll say, oh, Mom, I'll be with you in 10 or 15 minutes. I'm busy right now. And of course, 10 or 15 minutes later, I figured it out for myself. And she knows that I'm going to do that. And she doesn't tell me. And she will keep doing whatever she's doing as long as she has to till I figured it out for myself. So, you know, there's no winning.
I love that. So the spirit of your husband is working through your daughter still the time.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Your husband would be so proud of you, Elaine, to see what you're doing now and helping your peers in with technology the way that you do it. It's just, I admire that so much.
Well, it's something that, as I say, I'm not afraid of playing with my computer. And that's what everybody's very, I remember when they first came, were being used at the hospital. And the person who was looking after them, she said, oh, be careful, don't touch them. You know, you have to be careful, because if you hit the wrong button, then it's going to explode. It's like, okay. And that was how people were, especially at the beginning. It was really weird. And
one more question for you, because you have done these two legacy videos with us. You've done a story interview or story legacy and an interview legacy. And I'm sure you've shared that with people. What kind of reactions are you getting from people who have watched your video? You've got quite a few views on your video. I think the elephant video has 118 views or something like that. So just wonder what you've heard from some of the people who've watched it.
People have said that they've enjoyed it. You know, I don't get a lot of comments really. If I ask people and they say, oh yes, we really liked it, sort of thing.
Because it is really interesting, because it documents a trip that you took to Botswana, right?
Yes.
So what we were able to do with this little clip I'm going to show you, it's just a portion of Elaine's video that I just distilled today for the purposes of this program. But what we decided to do, just something different, is to actually put some footage at the end that Elaine herself had taken while she was there. And that enhanced the video so much. So without further ado, I will share that with everybody so they can. Yeah, great. Awesome. So I will just start again. So hopefully everybody has had a chance to watch Elaine's video. And we're just going to close now with a little song about friendship between strangers, which is what StoryShare is all about.
For sale or rent, rooms to let 50 cents, no phone, no pool, no pets. I ain't got
2 hours of push and broom, buys an 8x12 four bedroom. I'm a man of means, by no means king of the road. Third boxcar, midnight train, destination Bangor, Maine. Old worn out suit and shoes, I don't pay no union dues. I smoke old stogies I have found, short but not too big around. I'm a man of means, by no means king of the road. I know every engineer on every train, all of their children and all of their names, and every handout in every town, and every lock that ain't locked when no one's around. I sing trailers for sale or rent, rooms to let 50 cents. No phone, no pool, no pets. I ain't got no cigarettes. I got 2 hours of push and broom, buys a 8x12 four bedroom. I'm a man of means, by no means king of the road, king of the road, king of the road.
Thank you. Thank you. I'd like to thank Marissa Singh and Elaine Montgomery for joining me tonight. I'd like to thank Eric Potty of beautiful Airdrie Public Library, who does such innovative programming for everything that you've done to help us and to put this program together. Thank you, Eric. And I will turn it back over to you now to close.
Yeah, perfect. Thank you, Doreen. Thank you, Marissa and Elaine. Thank you, everyone. For those who are viewing, appreciate it. It's always great to be able to offer these kinds of programs, to be able to do this. We love to be able to have people share, informal storytelling like this and in informal storytelling. So we're always very pleased to be able to have you and have everyone, share a great resource. Hopefully, people are able to watch this and discover that they have their own stories to share with everyone.
Did we say it was free? It's free.
Perfect. That, hey, we at the library, we love things that are free. So that's perfect. So thank you so much. I definitely appreciate all the effort and everything that went into it. And we're very pleased. And of course, Doreen, we look forward to whatever books and stories and things that you come up with next. So thank you so much, everyone. I hope you have a good night, and we'll see you in the library.